Vlogcasts may occasionally contain explicit content that makes it not safe for work or for minors. It also doesn't provide an excuse to use the same words on Bay 13. Normal big footy rules still apply.
So this is the Vlogcast for round 8. Starburns joined by Cooksen.
Hello.
Penal.
G'day.
Teach.
Hey.
Haduken.
Hello.
Morganashlee.
Hello.
And for his first appearance of the year after a big, big win for his Brion's Paddles.
Hey, welcome back, Paddles.
But yeah, we will start actually with the Brion's popping the puffer fish and in a quite significant fashion. You know, it wasn't a close game, which makes it all the more remarkable. They blew him out of the water.
I actually about this. It coincides with their Brion the Lion thing. What they did was they hyped up Mitch Robinson on a heap of red cordial. And then they ran him through it. He thought he was at a showground. You know, he's at the fair or, you know, maybe a rave. And he fired up and played the game of his life. You know, really worked. Oh. Fired him up.
To be honest, though, being at the game, I thought it was pretty embarrassing. Just like watching this cheer squad just spend like several minutes just pumping this thing up.
They weren't as prepared as North. They weren't as familiar with an inflatable lion as a sausage, were they?
Oh, what's going on with that fucking lion?
Hey. It's better than a real one, okay? Because the real one would have killed someone.
Hodgepodge dislikes this.
Look, they wanted a real lion, and then someone's obviously said, what if it eats people? And they've gone, what's the next best thing? North's gone with the inflatable shower curtain. Maybe we could try that. Maybe big inflatable lion. I actually, for all the shitty stuff to laugh at and the fan engagement, there's been some bizarre ones. That is actually one of the better ones, I think. It's not terrible.
I don't mind the big sausage shower curtain, but the inflatable lion, oh my God, that's just fucking hopeless.
It's a bit American, but it worked. I mean,
it works in America, and I know everyone, the backlash is, you know, if it's American, it doesn't mean it's good, but I think there's actually an element where if you do it right, it can look all right. Like, I don't think Brisbane quite had it right, but there's something to work with. Maybe it can be smaller.
Let's be honest here. As bad as it was, it's still not quite as embarrassing as the fucking Never Tear Us Apart song at Adelaide Oval.
Oh, Port have lost two in a row now, so I think we can expect the Bay Cup to make it.
Hang on, Port have lost, but didn't Paddy Ryder save them?
Weren't they going to be 10-2 after 12 weeks?
Yeah, like, isn't he the difference between them being sort of also around middle of the table shit heaps and premiership contenders?
Paddy's got a ban hanging over his head again.
They look like they're on the skids, don't they, Hadooks?
Well, you know, I mean, Paddy Ryder was, you know, Jesus Christ reincarnated, according to a lot of them. And clearly he should have made the difference and at least 6 wins by now. What's going on?
How was Rockcliffe's game, by the way?
Uninspiring. I actually sort of realised, I didn't realise Zorko was back. If I had realised he was back, I would realise there's now more effective midfielders than ineffective in there. So they were actually in the shot. I didn't actually look at his stats. I've got to admit, I'm assuming.
I thought he played, Dane Beams played pretty well.
Ah, there you go. Someone else picked up his
stats. Yeah, he did. Yeah. Sorry, Morgan.
I think their win coincides with the fact that the shit beams didn't play. And I'm sensing that is why it occurred. There's only room for one beams there, so.
That's a fair comment. Well. Fair comment.
Hang on, let's have a look at the stats here. Tom Rockcliffe.
Just while he's bringing up the stats, what's your opinion on Tom Rockcliffe, Paddles? Because I don't think you've been on with Haduken for a while to be able to sort of riposte his argument.
I think I've only like briefly seen that thread that he started like last year about Rockcliffe being ineffective. To be honest, he's been...
You're going to take a win, aren't you? Every day of the week.
Yeah, of course.
Actually, by Tom's especially standards, he had 4 inside 50s. Whoa, that's huge for him.
What a quarter.
Oh, of 28 disposals. 63.2% disposal efficiency.
So he was on fire. Fireman Kane didn't put him out.
By his standards, he actually had a cracker of a game. Still about their fourth best midfielder.
Who else played good was Mitch Robinson. 3 goals.
That would have made him Carlton's most effective forward on the weekend.
It's a pretty funny result. So,
fuck him. Fisher out of puffs, so.
The puffers have hit the skids. Kane. He's obviously got some bodies buried in barrels in South Australia. He's preempted the fireman defence.
Kenny can't coach for shit. Now
has anyone seen Chad recently?
Now, Phil Walsh is gone. Yeah, he was the brains, clearly.
I mean, it must be bad if you want to be a fucking fireman out of AFL.
And the other thing is, equalisation. Cookie mentioned it last week. It was this week even greater example of that, that just about any team can win on any given day. Unless you're Carlton in Australia.
Let's just all take a moment to appreciate that fact. And
yes. who is that Hmong that made the thread on the main board? NBA man? Oh, dear. What a fucking
We could come to the flog of the week, Tom. I want that thread to come to the Bay. I've been hinting at it on the mod. It's like, when you finish with that, just send it to us. I'm going to give it a meltdown prefix. Let's move on. We'll go to Richmond Collingwood. And
Tigers!
Well, that is the type of football I've been waiting for 6 weeks. And it just, it actually... Actually, it's even more perplexing when you see it like that. Where's it been?
What about you, Morgan? I mean, you must have not enjoyed that much at all.
Oh, there were parts that were really enjoyable, like the first quarter. We were quite effective. We moved the ball really well. We defended well. And then come the second quarter, we turned to shit. And... It was
you were
perplexing.
Witches hats for like the first 6 minutes of that second quarter. It was lovely. It was like,
oh, you're woeful.
It's like watching Carlton, pretty much.
I don't think we came back from the huddle. Like, we just stayed there. I don't understand how they can be poles apart 15 minutes into a game. They're just fucking ridiculous.
Those pricks cost me a free burger too. That's my lunch down the toilet. Fucking hell.
Wait, you pick Brisbane.
Is Pendlebury injured? Yes. Because he was shit
out.
He was carrying an ankle.
Yeah.
Yeah, he wasn't very good. Swan was pretty good for Collingwood, but our midfielders went direct for once, and people can say what they like about Deledio, but we are a much better side when he is in there. And he took nearly twice as many marks in that game than Nick Nat's taken all year.
He's a soft cock, but he knows how to play some damn fine footy.
He was very good in the last quarter. Very Clutch. Good.
And how is Tyrone Vickery?
Yeah, well, we will come to Tyrone, but look, he's just bored himself another month in the side, no matter how shit he plays. So he's actually kind of trolling us a little bit. It's the Cameron Wood scenario, like at Carlton. I think Short mentions this every time Cameron Wood plays a decent game. It's enough for Carlton to pick him a little bit longer. And there are, every team's got one of those players where they just do enough. So McBean will come in for one game and go out and Griffiths comes back.
What about Oxley, your man Oxley, Morgs? He played a bit of a shocker.
He was closely followed by Seedsman, who also played a dog of a game. So
Seedsman's probably up all night impregnating
people. Whoa. Are we hanging shit on the seed here?
No, we can't.
Oh, yes, well, we can.
It wasn't his fault. He only had Jesse White to kick to.
Is there a problem when Dugowie plays as well? And so all the Collingwood love is split, and so they're only running at half power.
Dugowie was impressive.
The seed and
Dugowie. Corey Ellis was better.
Like, I only have enough love to give for one, and it went to Dugowie, and he was fantastic in his first full game. He had more stats than Seedsman had in his first full game. Kicked a goal. Seedsman didn't do that. He kicked it out on the full, which probably cost us a win. So he's actually responsible.
Well, how are you going to address this problem? You can't love them both at the same time.
I don't see
Hawthorne supporters don't have this problem. We always have enough love to spread around with all our players.
I'm sure my goo will grow for them, but until then, I'm team Dugowie.
Short's no longer your friend, you know.
Yeah, that's
we cannot hang shit on Seedsman. The universe is going to fucking
I'm not even. I'm not even going to go there. I'm going to call this an aberration. And
yes, it's an aberration.
He just didn't care. That's all.
He had an uncharacteristic Chris Judge.
Yes.
He banged Megan Gale before game, that's why.
Oh, shit. If you did that, I mean, you'd just be, you know, just
drinking.
It was nice to see the young players play. It's disappointing McBean will go out, but at least they're getting picked and hopefully Steve Morris can be out next. But I'm still not sold on Hardwick or the game plan, but hey, it was a start. So we'll see how we go against the struggling Puffers next week.
Sean Grick played well. I think he did. He picked 2 goals for the X's.
By the standards of this way we've been playing this year, he's actually had a pretty good season. He hasn't dropped his head. He hasn't set the world on fire, but he hasn't been shit. Like, he's not been Cotchin, who's been sideways crabby. He's actually been contested and he's tried.
I've been meaning to ask this for ages to any Richmond supporter. What the hell is wrong with how Trent Cotchin kicks the ball?
It's his stabby thing, isn't it? He doesn't kick very well in the straight line. It's like he's got used to having to put the ball in his boot quickly, winning it in close, that he doesn't realise when he's got more time. He's like a great snap kick, but when he's running straight at a target, he gets a little bit, I don't know, it's like he thinks he's about to be tackled.
It's like a reverse Sean McKernan who puts his head up around his, you know, ear every time he kicks it. He just drops it down to ankle level and crouches down and does this little weird stab kick. I've never really seen anyone do it like he does.
He misses set shots because he stabs as well. Like, I was surprised he kicked that one in the second quarter because he's a terrible set shot kick.
Maybe he's trying to just decrease any chance that the wind can take it anywhere.
Well, as we know, he cares little for what the wind does to the football.
As we know, when he kicks into it.
Yes, he doesn't care much for the wind. He'll kick into it because the wind's irrelevant. Is that everything on that game or anything more?
Travis
Cloak do with a free kick every now and again, but we'll move on from that. We'll take the moral with him. We'll keep going.
Oh, Buckley had a bit of a moan, didn't he?
He doesn't melt often, Bucks, so he can have that.
He's a cross between Brad Scott and Plugger after that.
He looked like Hitler at the end of his rage videos, just so depressed, downcast.
Speaking of Brad Scott, we'll go to the Friday night game, which was a good game of football, ruined by Lindsay Thomas, the dirty ducking cunt.
It was what a game.
Don't hold back. Tell us what you really think, Starburns.
He's fucking awful, isn't he?
Well, yes. He had the sort of antics going that would have really pissed me off if they weren't playing Essendon. But because it was Essendon, it was funny as fuck to watch him get those free kicks and to watch the Bombers crowd go mad and to watch Melksham have a sook.
But the only thing worse than Lindsay Thomas, I think, was that Essendon pre-match lights going out. Like, that was very...
What's wrong with that? That was good.
Oh,
just
yeah.
The Chicago Bulls did that shit in the 90s.
Okay, Haduken, I'm going to raise you a scenario here.
Yep.
Lights are on, everyone's happy. Lights go off. Come on a minute later. Bombers is gone and so's some woman.
What?
You know, just saying.
Not really. I wouldn't have thought so, Fifey.
I tried to fit a Bombers joke in there. It didn't go so well.
Bombers 2003. Bombers 2003. I thought you meant Bomber Thompson.
That's what it was. Yeah.
Fuck.
I was going to say, the fuck is this? I don't even.
If the lights go off, Bombers 2003, at a game.
I wouldn't go to a game with Bombers.
Yeah, exactly. Like,
or any would. Like, vulnerable people.
Not convicted.
Exactly.
But back to the game. It was entertaining enough.
It was a really good game of football. I was actually less angry at the end of that game than it was when we beat Carlton.
Was that because you moved the ball better?
Yeah, we actually played.
Because you've had the same problem as us. You've been crabbish as well.
You know, we beat Carlton, but we played so shittily that Carlton were almost competitive. That's how badly we were playing.
You didn't play bad, Hadoops.
No, not at all. And so when we lost, I kind of walked away and went, well, you know, that really could have gone either way. There's a bit of luck one way or another, like McKernan's not Mark and all that sort of stuff. That you can say here or there. I wasn't upset, basically. I thought we played all right.
It was an honourable loss.
Yeah.
We would say brave, but I think enough people have said it.
I'll say, I found Heppel to be a bit disappointing this season. I mean,
he hasn't been as good, not compared to last year. A few of our players are down a bit across the board, just doing little things like kicking and handballing under pressure. You know, they're just not managing it. But if we keep this form up, where we are on the ladder is probably fair, 11th. But we can improve and we can be better, as we saw when we beat Hawthorne, for example.
You may remember that.
Not me this time.
So we're capable of better, but whether we'll do it, I don't know.
But yeah, it was a good game, and Sean Higgins delivering for North. Like, what's far out? Is this actually happening? North are getting something out of Waiton Higgins. This has to come to an end at some point, surely.
Well, the potential's back. The potential for him to be suspended at any given moment.
He should have been suspended.
He's going to get suspended, isn't he? Yep.
No, it's fine.
That was a Jordan Lewis, except that Waite's brain goes at a snail's pace compared to Lewis's, so he didn't decide to whack him in the head until the last minute. But he drops the fist.
Yeah, he changed direction.
I thought he was going to get suspended.
He gives him
the
clumsy Jared Waite whack, like the clumsy in quotation marks, because it's deliberate, but it looks clumsy because it's Waite.
Both decisions by the MRP this week were pretty ordinary.
Yeah, well, we'll come to the other one of that later, goo chugger.
Oh, is that the opposition team's guy?
Yeah, the Bulldogs opposition, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, so we will move on to the Dogs. Yeah, getting within 13 points of their opposition, who remained 7-0. And, yeah, that was brave, I think.
Well, considering that the opposition got out to such a good start, they really reeled them back in.
Yeah, they were close enough at three-quarter time to make a run of it.
They came really hard at them, but you got to hand it to them. They're top of the ladder. They're 7 in a row. Oh,
they're boring. Fuck them.
Yeah, look, their best player, who's probably the only reason to watch him. Yeah, I don't think there was much in that trip, to be perfectly honest.
Oh, I reckon he's gone.
He got off.
Nah, he's got a fine.
Off with a fine.
He got off!
He should have got a week.
Are you kidding me? He got off for that?
Dustin Fletcher, he would have got 3 weeks.
Dustin Fletcher never got suspended for a trip by leg, like, except for that one time on Judd, which was awful.
He's been done for tripping about 4 times.
I thought he always gets reported, and the Judd one was the only time he got suspended.
No, he got one for...
Yeah, but he's got gadget leg.
Arms, yeah.
No, I reckon he gets a game for tripping every other year, so Hadouks is definitely on the money.
He trips
with his hands instead of his legs, and the MRP did change, and it's now full of players who are genuinely hard and players who will look the other way, so every player is probably a bit lucky, but still, it's better for the game.
Well, except for Stephen May.
I just want to be completely clear about this. Is Fifey got off on the trip? Is that right?
Yes. It was almost as bad as Stevie J getting off.
I'm waiting for them to send the 2014 Coleman medal to Jared Ruffhead, because Ruffhead got done for a trip like that, exactly like that, last year, and he would have won the Coleman last year if not for that.
Moral Coleman.
Yep, moral Coleman to Ruffy. Back to back.
Do we have anything else on the Bulldogs getting close to their opposition?
I thought the Bulldogs played really well, particularly after the St Kilda game the previous week, because what happened against the Saints was when the Saints got a run on, the Bullies went into their shell and stopped playing football and tried to save the game. They didn't do that this week against their opponent. They took the game on. They were brave. They moved the ball well. That was really great. And they deserve to probably beat their opposition, considering a few umpiring calls went against them late in the game. But, you know, that's the way the game works sometimes.
Nothing about that game has made me change my opinion that the Bulldogs are the real deal, and that on their day they can beat anyone, even the current leader of the ladder.
As long as day is not a prelim.
Well, the question is, can they handle... finals football?
No.
Probably not. They'd never be. Well, no. Don't underestimate them.
They can handle the first 2 weeks.
So they might do a Port, because Port certainly aren't going to do it.
One day they're going to win a prelim. One day.
And then they'll get 150 points in the grand final.
When that happens.
One day their opposition might win a premiership too. Anyway.
Oh, shots fired.
Let's move on to, well, Mick Malthouse went full job preservation mode and dropped all the kids for his journeyman, and they got fucked by the greatest margin the Giants have ever won by.
How delicious.
I actually watched that game just to enjoy watching it crushed. And they were. And it was most pleasing.
How was the one where the Toby Green kicks it along the ground in front of goal, the dribble kick to centre, and does the leg break past the Carlton player to, I think it was Stewart, and he snaps the goal. Just shit like that. It was.
Was it Sam Rowe giving shit to Jeremy Cameron, and the commentators going, don't poke the bear. We're five minutes into this.
Goals.
It was just beautiful. It was more enjoyable than watching us win this year. For them to bring in all of their experienced players and drop the kids and then perform like absolute sacks of shit, it was so nice.
I must admit, about halfway through the second quarter, someone said Thomas, and I thought, not Daisy Thomas, is it? Really?
Played a full game.
Oh, he's actually there. Okay, and he was shithouse.
But he's genuinely not any good anymore, and it's fantastic.
Because I think their best player is still Chris Judd. Yeah. Their board is full of corrupt criminals. Their coach is a giant cunt who can't coach for shit nowadays.
Is Edelston on their board?
No, he's their assistant coach.
Have you got a strong opinion about that, Cookie, or are you just...
I'm just saying how hilarious it is how they for 100 years talked about how strong and rich they are, and now they're shit. Enjoy being shit.
And it looks like they'll be shit for a while longer because they've got no good kids coming through.
Because GWS stole them all, cry us a river.
They don't know if they're any good because they won't play the fucking things.
How many number one picks do you need?
Depends how many times you can pick Bryce Gibbs.
they could have 100 and they'll still fuck it up.
The only good kids that they have, like Patrick Cripps, because he goes all right, he'll probably leave to go to another club because they're paying 700k to Daisy Thomas.
But they have have some kids that aren't awful. Like, Cripps is good. Doherty's all right, but he came from Brisbane. Like, Nick Graham can't get a game. And fucking spuds like Carrazzo do. Like, it just doesn't make sense.
Carrazzo tried to almost knock out Murphy with a stray forearm.
It was the closest he came to doing anything useful. Fuck.
When Mark Murphy is your captain, it's time to give up as a football club. That's it, really.
Look, it's getting to the point where, I don't know, we can laugh at him as much as we can, but it just...
Yeah. I'm calling the MMA tap out.
throwing a towel on behalf of...
We've got a whole year to get one more left.
Tap out,
Matthew Watson.
Matthew Watson made Liam Jones' efforts look good.
I've never seen someone run around like him just looking so lost. Like, where he was supposed to go?
He was another failed first round.
Was he a first rounder?
Yeah, I think they took him to pick before Isaac Smith.
You got the hay fever again, Starburns.
Carlton's bullshit is that bad, well spread, it affects Starburns.
He is allergic to them. We all should be.
No, I'm not allergic to shitness. I follow Richmond. Let's move on. Crows beat the Saints quite comfortably.
It was a good effort by us, but again, we lost two players early, and you'd expect an experienced outfit like the Crows to run over, but disappointed that Rewalt got injured and young Jack Loney, but fuck me, the commentators, Jesus Christ.
And which commentators? Just, can you just tell us which commentators? Because this may be a familiar theme here.
Big nose dickhead Basil. And Mr. My Brother's in charge, so give me a job, private schoolboy dickhead Haim.
Look, we had a crack at Basil last week, and he was shit again calling it. But yeah, Revolt was apparently brave was the term. He tackled the guy.
He tackled badly, that's my
opinion. He tackled badly, and he came off second best, which wasn't the greatest thing. But
he didn't end up all that well, but...
But you don't call him brave for being a little bit clumsy.
Yeah, I mean...
what do you do? I mean, you're over there, it's always tough to beat him over there.
I'm not saying... It was just really silly commentary from two guys who just are idiots.
They know fuck all about the area.
They do know fuck all about the area.
It was a romping win.
I will say Josh Bruce was excellent again, kicking.
He's genuinely
goals.
Good.
Yeah, and considering that you have a few other tall forward options up there, like you've got McCartan coming through and you've got White, who's supposedly all right, and Membry from the Swans, you're tracking all right that you can bring them along one by one now that Bruce is...
I'm going to throw a theory out there that Alan Richardson is actually a pretty decent development coach from the looks of things.
I think
so
you're
far.
Right, Dukes.
Things are going all right for them.
He did do a lot of development in the past. I think most of his jobs were in development leagues.
That's what he did at Essendon back in 2008 and 9 or so.
So under Knights.
That's for you.
Yeah, that's great. Knights and Richardson, they were developing a reasonable side. I'm not going to get into the whole Knights herd thing. But, you know, the side was coming along.
I think Penal drags back there later.
Yeah, isn't your current development coach Mark Neild or something?
No.
What's his face from Adelaide?
Neil Craig.
Neil Craig. He's a development coach. I don't know what the hell Neil does, stand around and look angry.
He's your money ball man. He's the one who brought McKernan to the club.
Hey, North Melbourne were nearly McKernanated.
Let's move on to Hawthorn beating Melbourne quite comfortably. The only thing out of this game I think that warrants discussion, apart from Melbourne getting smashed for being shit, is that Jack Watts was dropped by Jack Watts.
He intercepted himself out of the squad.
That is how much of a bitch he is. If he's thrown him, doesn't even want to play anymore. Like, it's not like he's getting into anything difficult. He's not going near the fucking ball. Just stand there, cunt. Just stand there.
He should just piss off and start filming lesbian porn. I mean, that's a fucking use
for him. And he hasn't even done it for goods reasons, because he's cracked the sads over the sub. He's going, I just don't want to do anything. I want to go back into the BFL where maybe they won't touch me.
No one will see that I'm fucking hopeless.
I'm sick of those nasty Melbourne supporters jeering me when I get my third touch in the fourth quarter.
It's not like there's many of them there anyway. It can't be that bad.
If you want a player to breed the personification of Melbourne Football Club for the past 10 years, it's Jack Watts.
And if he had have played, he could have played on clangers. Like, if anything's going to boost anyone's confidence, it's that.
He could have kicked five goals.
Nah, he dropped himself because he was afraid of having a bag kicked on him by Schoenmakers.
If someone kicked it long to a contest between Watts and Schoenmakers, who would fuck it up worse?
They would cuss each other and someone would come through and clean it up. It's like dividing by zero.
Because Schoenmakers is actually an all right forward. I mean, I'm not going to go to the levels that Hodgepodge did, because Hodgepodge made a thread about Schoenmakers winning the Coleman next year or something. I'm not gonna go there.
He didn't, did he?
He did. He made a thread yesterday about how great Schoenmakers was. I'm not going to go to that level, but he is an all right forward. And we saw that on the weekend.
Funnily enough, I actually agree. agree with you. He could be a semi-serviceable forward in the mould of a Tyrone Vickery. Or a Jesse White.
Gee, no, set the bar high there, Fifey. He's almost as good as Liam Jones.
I see him more in the Cozzy mould, Starburns.
Cozzy was good.
Yeah, that's
for
that's
four the, games.
He was going to knock himself out.
Did anyone hear Jeff Kennett going off his tits again?
Yeah,
today about the Melbourne board and that they should all resign.
Because they didn't let him on. They didn't want Jeff. So Jeff's, you know.
Yeah.
Jeff did fuck all to help build Hawthorn. It was all the previous guys. He just came in and says, oh, look, everything's built for me.
I'll play more games in Tassie. Full relocation.
Indicated everything at Hawthorn.
Yeah.
Going back to the Sean Makers thing, I don't know if you guys noticed because you probably didn't watch this game, but David Hale got subbed off. And after that, Clarko pulled one out of the Robert Wall's bag of tricks. And he's like, if you've got a player who isn't doing all right, throw him into the ruck. And so Sean Makers rucked for the last quarter.
Did it help?
He was all right. He got
You were fucking 100 points up.
Half a dozen hit outs. I think he's a better ruck than Natanui. I will say that.
How many marks did he take? That's the important question.
He's taken more marks than Natanui this year.
At least they've managed to find a position for him with no accountability, finally.
Oh, that's a good note to move on from. Let's go to, well, the Cats are back to being concerning. Didn't take long.
Mm.
Well, look, I thought that we were competitive for three quarters.
It was one of those games, Teach. Honestly, I watched that one. You never quite looked there. Sydney always just seemed to have your measure, and we're just putting the pedal down through the course of the whole game.
You're right. You're dead right. I didn't think we would ever win it. We didn't have Hawkins and...
Yeah, that was a big out.
And their firepower...
Emphasis on big.
Their firepower is pretty, pretty damn good. And so I always thought that we'd get the clips, but we were in it for three quarters.
Well, did anyone notice Luke Parker 30-5'd?
Yeah.
He goes,
all therefore right, making him the greatest player of all time, pretty much.
He was
probably the greatest game of all time, surely.
He was very, very good, yeah. Can't take it away from him. You know, they just waxed us in the last quarter, so that's what I expected.
There was someone who looked a bit shit for Sydney, and that is Kurt Tippett.
Right.
Oh, yeah, he's a spaz, isn't he?
Getting paid 800,000, and he's just been so shit this year.
I know. What a...
make Sam Reed look good.
Oh, definitely. Yeah.
Reed's fucking hopeless, too. He was hopeless. Like, if they didn't have Franklin and some of those midfielders. Like,
well, that's what.
Sydney developed very bad tall forwards.
No, that's why.
And then sends them out.
They got to buy him.
Yeah, Plugger Loggett and Barry Hall.
Ooh, trend there.
Yeah. Lance
it looks like in the case of Kurt Tippett, they've managed to buy one who is complete shit and is being rated on the basis of like one good season in 2009.
And one decent prelim.
So that's kind of like Jared Waite.
How did Sam Blees go for the Cats?
He was a sub.
He was on the field at one point. I know they said, here he comes.
Sam Blees, your new recruit from Melbourne.
Peach, I just noticed too that you were a bit gooey over Rhys Stanley.
Oh, Stanley is playing out of his skin. He is just busting every single arsehole that he smacks.
I can confirm he was definitely on the ground and did play.
But there was talk about seriously.
Sam Blees, fuck off, you loser.
I can't confirm. Other than I heard them announce him, but I didn't see him, and I never saw him again in the whole game.
And one last thing from that game. Well, Stevie J.
Oh, nut punch.
A hard ball get right there.
Yeah, probably the first of the season for Stevie. What are your thoughts on that, Penal, considering what happened to Jordan Lewis, who clearly wanted to hit someone as well, but got 3 weeks for getting them in the head?
Look, let's face it. Steve Johnson's a thug, and he should be deregistered for life.
Oh, so he's as bad as Lee Matthews.
Yeah. He didn't go for life, did he? He got a couple of weeks, Lee Matthews, but Stevie J has just proved over and over that you can't let him on a football field. It's like Mr. Aaron in a children's playground. It just is not a good mix because something will go wrong.
Jesus.
I don't know if he's quite elbows Hodge level, but he's, you know, getting there. He hasn't pinched anyone.
Eagles versus Suns.
Suns are shit. Eagles are good.
Who cares? Move on.
12 straight.
Didn't that just sub Jack Kennedy out?
Preserving him to make sure that the X's keep beating Carlton. Yeah. Got to play all season.
He could have skied all the way down there. We could have been 20 goals up the X's.
Think long term, Morgs. Think long term. Yeah. Plenty of teams for Kennedy to ski over by the look of things this year.
I don't know about that elbow.
They're second on the ladder. Actually, West Coast.
We'll be sure he kicks 10 goals this week.
Who did the elbow? What are you talking about, Morgan?
Okay, he's got a dodgy elbow.
Oh, he injured it, but it seemed didn't seem to stop him kicking goals last week.
Well, he didn't a Gold Coast player didn't get near him, so it's not going to affect him this week.
Yeah,
well,
he's got St Kilda next week, so they should be right.
He's playing hurt. Sorry, Cookie. But obviously, he can play. Pritis, I thought, went really well. I think Bender made the comment during the week that it was another 3-vote winning performance from Pritis.
You and fucking Pritis. You cocksucking dickhead.
Pritis dual Brownlow medalist. Is it possible? Can you imagine if Pritis beat Fife again?
It's happening.
Let's go to the talking points. WADA have appealed and the circus is back in town.
So what's going to happen there? Yeah,
well, not really. I mean, all the commentators are going a bit feral, but nothing's actually going to happen now for another 6 months.
The circus is in Switzerland, a nice neutral country full of neutrality.
Yeah, it's all tied up in legal shit, so it's going to be months.
Well, okay, quickly around, do we think the result's going to be overturned at all?
No.
I don't think it will.
Not unless the magical evidence fairy has appeared somewhere.
Yeah. The magical fairy.
David Hill.
The comment was interesting that Lance Armstrong would have gotten off at that tribunal because obviously they didn't come out
and
say...
Who made that comment? What relevance does that have to anything?
Jared Waitley said that. Well, the AFL tribunal had been hearing the Lance Armstrong case, they'd have found him not guilty on the same evidence.
Armstrong had several teammates come out and say he took drugs with us, we took drugs.
Yes, but with the way they interpreted comfortable satisfaction, he would have been found not guilty was the same.
To be honest, I couldn't give a fuck because Essendon is shit anyway.
Maybe they'll have heard for a while longer. Unless, of course, he gets sued into bankruptcy because James Heard last week, in the aftermath, got a little bit angry, Scott McLaren-esque, when he got himself in legal trouble and accused the SADA of shredding documents.
Oh, yeah?
Yes.
That makes zero sense.
Bomber Thompson has come out and said, yep, the SADA took him. We don't know what happened to him.
Bomber Thompson said he wasn't invited to the reunion, too.
He invented a spreadsheet, which apparently was ridiculous that it came so late in the piece that it's irrelevant to the investigation and what was discussed.
Well, fucking anyone.
He actually said that they gave it to them,
the SADA
got rid of it.
They're saying that they took it on day one, like when they raided Essendon and took all the documents, so they came and got it.
Yeah, but the document related to the last couple of months of it, none of the stuff that Asada was looking at that's still undocumented.
Is this for the stuff that they can't even prove made it into Australia?
Yes, the same stuff.
Yeah, right. Okay.
Let's get back to it. He's accused him of shredding documents. That's basically what he said. He said that it went missing and Asada got rid of it. That was pretty much word for word what he said. And, you know, he's on the back foot. He's got his dad taking pot shots at government for him.
Yeah, he's dead. His dad popped up in the media, didn't he?
Yeah, everyone's having a crack, aren't they?
Jeez.
What did he compare it to? There's a nice metaphor in there. It was quite Pontius Pilate. So all of a sudden, James has been elevated to Christ-like
Jesus
status
Christ,
by his own dad.
Right. I wonder if he's got an imaginary friend in the sky.
Look, it's given us plenty of ammunition. The Essendon
it's been a wonderful 3 years.
He's back in full swing now, thanks to that. But yeah, look, we're going to have to deal with it for another 6 months or more.
We could just pretend it's not happening.
Well,
no, that's what we're doing.
We could, but there is the Essendon board constantly delivering us stuff, and there will be Robbo writing pieces, and there'll be Caro trying to destroy Herd's life, apparently.
And Bosk still posts on Big Footy. Actually, just unban him and leave him, and that way nothing will happen.
No, that's his own fault. The AFL have proposed a new fixture, which was a 17-round season of everyone playing once and then splitting the ladder into three groups of six based on ladder position and to determine the finals and the draft picks at the bottom six.
They could just do it from last year's ladder position and just use the same, split the ladder into three as well, but and just use that. That seems a lot more logical because it also means...
That artificially inflates the bottom teams, though. This ladder sounds like the worst suggestion from the AFL that isn't a NAB Cup rule.
Honestly, I'm not really sure how it would work, so I guess I'd want to see it in action maybe for a year to try it.
The idea is if you were in the top six after round 17, you can't fall out of the top six.
Yeah. So what are you playing for? Just your finals position?
You're playing for ranking.
Home finals.
Yeah.
Right, okay.
Top two.
And
top
seventh
four.
To 12th are playing for seventh and eighth spot but can't fall lower, and the bottom six somehow play for draft picks. I'm not sure how that works. It sounds like tanking and three irrelevant games a week.
Yeah, I think 13th is meant to get number one. one, so the incentive is to play for 13th. But yeah, what that happens if you're 12th?
Oh, they reverse order it. Okay.
Yeah, if you're like 12th and you are two games off 7th, so you can't make finals, you're incentivized to try and tank to try and get 13th, because chances are that if you're sort of that 10th to 12th place side, you'll be able to finish 13th, get number one. So it incentivizes teams who probably will just miss out on the 8th to try and tank to get as low as possible to 13th.
And no offense, Paddles, but look, we saw Carlton Brisbane a week ago. We don't want to see Carlton Brisbane for a second time this year, which is what this system would create. We'd have that game again and various games like it, you know, and Carlton versus Gold Coast and Carlton versus Melbourne, all twice over. Do we really want those?
But don't we get that now anyway?
Well, no, because there's a chance that they don't play them. They'd play all those teams twice. So there'd be those games.
But if you are genuinely the worst team in the league, you can't be expected to... Yeah, say if you are Carlton, you now get pick 6 in the draft or pick 5 or whatever fucking pick you get, when you should get the first pick because you are the worst.
To be fair, Carlton would probably do a better job with pick 6 than pick 1.
Well, no, last time they had pick 6, they drafted Yaron.
Yeah, better than fucking...
Close to their best player at the moment.
Cameron Wood's their best player.
There's no real good idea to do it because 18 does not go into 22 or 23. Yeah.
That's the best system. And anyway, was a conference
the AFL
style.
The AFL would never do it anyway because it doesn't guarantee the fucking two blockbusters a year, AFL's like idea. The Essendon Collingwood.
You can do it. I've seen somebody did one.
The AFL's idea, but the clubs told them to get stuffed.
Yeah, but I don't think they would ever implement it. They're just probably saying, you know, hey, we realize that the fixture is unfair and we're trying to do something about it, but they would never.
So if you get into a conference style, how would you work that?
I don't think you could properly do conferences because you have 8 interstate teams and 10 Victorian teams. I think you could do it with 9-9, but you couldn't do it with 10-8.
What if you rotated the conference?
If you rotated, a sort of rotation would work, yes.
Even if it was 10-10, it'd just make the interstate teams travel a lot more and the Victorian teams just stay in Melbourne, so it'd still be unfair. And also, the Lions and Swans fans in Melbourne would get fucked over.
You could do it 9-9 because you've got Hawthorn in Tasmania and then you've got the other 8 interstates.
Paddles, what Lions fans in Victoria? Because Fitzroy folded, remember?
Well,
oh, you mean bastard. Anyway, I don't give a fuck because for 10 games, you fuckers are coming down to Cadinia Park and you're getting fucked. So there you go.
Unless you're that team that's currently on top of the ladder and they'll win.
Yeah. And North beating there as well this year.
Yeah, they will probably beat us. Yes.
And unless you're a big Victorian side who never go down there.
Like Collingwood or Essendon.
You're coming.
No, they're Tasmanians.
You're coming, Cookie.
I'm well aware of that.
Fucking take you, Cookie.
Let's move on. Another thing mooted was the trading of future picks to try and get trades over the line.
So now Carlton can fuck up multiple years drafts in a row.
Well, yes, this is the fun. Who do we think could fuck this up worse?
Only Carlton. As Haduk said, only Carlton.
Crazy Vossi. Imagine Crazy Vossi with future picks. Paddles, your club would have folded for a second time.
what would happen if Crazy Vossi got hired by Carlton?
That's not a ridiculous thought.
He'll trade the next 20 years or draft picks for
he will trade Cripps to get Mitch Robinson back.
It's the 1,000 monkey theory. They're occasionally bound to get one draft pick correct. Just one.
Look, this idea has potential to get trades over the line, but you can just see someone fucking it up so badly.
I think another fuck up good candidate to fuck this up would be Mark Neal. Gee, I'm glad he's not at my club.
Or anywhere near a trade table, because he's not.
He'd probably trade the first round picks for to get Sam Blees back.
You could actually see
James Hurd deck him at the table live.
I reckon Geelong would also manage to stuff this up because they've had numerous concerning trades.
Yes. Can you imagine 2 first rounders for Reece Stanley?
Fuck off! Fucking Reece Stanley's been great.
You're still overpaid. Just wait till Goddard plays for St Kilda and you'll be thinking, what the fuck do we do trading for Reece Stanley? But yes, anything else on the future picks?
It works in American sports like the NBA because they have the drafting culture and the experience.
They do draft day trades too.
They have 32 teams in a league. So.
Yeah, it's and positional needs. In the NFL, it works like that too because there are so many positional needs and you want to, teams go nuts to land a quarterback. Like, if if anyone's heard of the Redskins, they traded 3 years worth of first rounders and a couple of second rounders to move up five draft spots and draft a quarterback who busted.
It was an RG3, was it?
It was RG3, yes, it was RG3. And this year, the Rams, who they traded with, actually, when they tossed the coin, sent the seven guys they drafted who were good players out to toss the coin against Washington as a troll, which was, I would love to see someone do that to Carlton.
Or the ex-Carlton forwards.
Yes, all the ex-Carlton forwards walk out there and just toss the coin, like send Eddie Betts to toss the coin against Carlton. That'd be great. But someone could fuck this up. Like, I know why they do it there. I know why it could work here, but I can see someone not knowing how it works and fucking it.
Has anyone seen the that movie Draft Day?
Yeah, that's so unrealistic, though.
I know.
That Jacksonville GM trades, like, for a first rounder for 4 seconds. No one does that.
I know.
Not even Crazy Bossy. But, yeah, that's how it works in theory. It could work, but I can just see someone misunderstanding it completely, like Brad Scott just scratching his head going, you know, who's the next Jared Waite?
By the way, how many weeks for him?
He got off too. Everyone's been done.
But they only got fines. No one got
weeks. All got fines. No one got suspended.
Fucking Jared Waite got off.
That guy who played against the Dogs this week is still eligible for the Brownlow.
What a fucking joke. Jared Waite, he punched the guy in the back of the head.
Let's move on. Cloak and Robbo versus social media. Robbo's written an article, and it's not about us. It's about Twitter users, because Robbo could never criticise Big Footy when he's got an account.
Big dog.
G'day, Robbo. How you doing?
Hey, big dog.
He'll be listening to this after his 12th beer of the morning. So, look, he's had a crack, and he listed some Bay 13 favourites. He listed Jack Watts. He listed Tyrone Vickery. He listed Ryan Schoenmakers. Have I missed anyone? Who else did he list in the article about being targeted? Trevor. Was Cloak, who had a sook of his own.
Yes.
It's what I said in the thread. I mean, if the media gives Jack what shit, oh, it's perfectly fine, their old boy. But we provide honest opinions. Who we're non-biased. We suddenly are evil. It's like, no, get fucked, Robbo.
Oh, I'm ridiculously biased.
No, yeah, I'm biased. And I have every right to say whatever I want about Travis Cloak not kicking goals. Because
you,
I turn up every week.
You pay his salary.
And I am exactly fucking right. I'm the reason he has a fucking job. So perhaps he should work harder to kick the fucking goal.
Mount Ashley, now in the podcast.
What else would he be if Morgs didn't help him become a footballer?
A zoo exhibition.
Yeah, no, he'd be in the circus.
He would be in the circus with all the fucking animals they have. It's that menagerie of a fucking clusterfuck of a house.
You done?
Kick the goals, Travis, for fuck's sake.
He's not Cameron Bad or whoever the other one was before them. It was another Cloak, wasn't it?
Jason Cloak.
He's never been kicked by Satanta, that's for sure.
Yeah, no, Cameron got kicked. Jason was okay in the back line if you hit him well enough. But
not often you see evolution in just one family like that.
Yeah, you say that because he was better looking, but he was fucking shit.
It is funny though, like these aren't rookie list players getting targeted either. Like, there's not many rookie list players who cop shit. It's the guys on the big money who actually should be doing more for what's
the guy earning the most money at our football club. You are getting paid more than anybody else in this team. You are the main person, and you fuck up every week. And
Watts has been on the list for 7 or 8 years on about 300k for or more for most of it. Now he's dropping himself. He's open to criticism.
Yeah, but
he's 24 now or 25. He should get over it.
And he'll always be number one to them.
Let's move on to the questions, and we will start with this one's for Morgs, and this one came from Cookie.
Thanks, Cookie.
Okay, how does it feel knowing that Tyrone Vickery played a good game against your team?
Well, the only reason this happens is because we have the only player that is worse than Tyrone Vickery in Jesse White.
He doesn't play on Vickery, though.
No, but they cancel each other out, and Jesse's so much fucking worse that Tyrone looks fantastic compared to him.
Didn't you look Jesse down one end of the ground goals?
And you see an absolute fucking potato.
When I was at the game, there was a guy sitting nearby me, and he kept yelling out every time the ball went near White, "Get out of the way, Jesse."
But that's what it's like. You look at him and you think you look like a footballer until he starts moving, or the ball comes near him, or a player comes near him. He's just fucking retarded.
He looks like a couple of ladders falling down a flight of stairs.
Looks like Tarzan plays like Jacqueline.
He's fucked. Like, I'll put Tony Armstrong in front of him. Fuck, he's useless.
Wow.
See, that's what I mean when I say Schoenmakers looks like an all right forward, because he's sort of demonstrably better than Jesse White and those sorts of players.
I'm demonstrably better than Jesse White.
Fair point.
That's the biggest melt we've ever had on the podcast for a player.
Let's try and be nice to this question asker this time. He's got a reasonable question. It's not about that team that played the Bulldogs this week. Not so it comes from Jose Mourinho. Will Port Pufferfish make the eight this season?
Ooh, yeah, I reckon they will. Yep, they will.
I still think they will, but I don't think top four's in the go anymore.
Three wins, four losses.
No, I reckon bottom part of the eight.
Seven or eight, and yeah, they've just been playing shit.
Port Adelaide to make the final needs to beat North Melbourne, Richmond, and Essendon, and they can't lose any of them.
Well, they can do all of that, I reckon.
If they do that, they'll win.
But if they don't, they're in trouble. Yeah. That's the point.
North can do them. I mean, Essendon, 50-50. Richmond, again, is a 50-50 with how they're going.
How we're going is like two quarters of football, but...
Maybe you're playing about half. Depends on which direction Cochin kicks in.
We are playing them next week, but yeah.
Fucking under-9s could beat Richmond right now.
We fucking won. You say they had a good stirring win, you cunt. Anyone else? Paddles, do Port make the 8? You watched them this week.
No, I reckon they won't.
Anyone that loses to Brisbane shouldn't be making the 8.
I think Port will make the 8.
This one comes from Moo. I hear the press conferences of Mick Malthouse and Rod Cadet are going to be made into a mini-series. Who do you think will play Mick and Rodney?
Ooh, I'm feeling Charles Dance might do really good at portraying Mick Malthouse. I mean, he'll nail
it. It's a bit of a shame that Charles Bronson is dead, because he would have been all right as Mick.
Who's the other one, Starburns?
Rocket Eid.
Danny DeVito.
I reckon Sean Connery for Malthouse.
He'd have the Scottish accent and be like,
"That's right, Gary."
Yeah, the accent like has to go, but got the old man kind of got that grumpy look about him.
No. For Malthouse.
Fucking shite.
For Malthouse, J.K. Simmons.
Guy out of Whiplash, yeah.
Out of Whiplash and Oz. And I reckon for Rocket.
You go Louis C.K. He's got that sort of build.
Yes. Louis C.K. Yes. Good one, Dukes.
You'd be like, oh, yeah, Gary would be great if you got the ball. And he cares about as much as Louis said, okay, in an interview. He's sitting there going, oh, yeah, football. We were playing, apparently. Yeah, we lost. Oh, well. Harley's drunk again. Oh, well. What are you going to do? Yeah.
But I reckon for Malthouse, you just got to get this sort of deranged old guy who's kind of lost all touch with reality. And I reckon...
Teach.
No, I reckon our man Bombers 03 could pull it off.
Well, he's obsessed with sausages and Malthouse, isn't he? We know that. So he's already been rehearsing for the role, really.
Natural fit.
Anyone else got a suggestion? Or is it peaked with that?
I'm thinking Jack Nicholson for Rodney Eade.
He's got way too much charisma for Rocket.
All right, let's move on to this week on the Bay. And before we go to Throw the Week and Flog of the Week, Morgs is on here particularly because of the events of yesterday. And after the game, she, well, may have won the internet just a little bit.
Oh, how did you do that? Tell us everything.
So Woosh and I were sitting in around the Richmond members area in Southern Stand, and we're sitting there at three-quarter time and looking at the ferals over in the Richmond cheer squad, and Woosh said that we should look for the KFC boy. So I sat there for a while and looking around, there's a lot of yellow and a lot of black, and then there was this big mop of fucking red. There he is. I could see him from here. He was 10 bays away and I could see him. I'm like, that's it. We're going to go and find him after the game. Woosh is like, we have to get a selfie with him. So the game finished. We lost. Didn't give a fuck because we were going to find the KFC boy. We ran around there. Woosh's poor husband had pulled all his shit. We left him there. Didn't find him for 40 minutes. Poor bastard. Didn't know if we'd ran away or not. We eventually got through the crowd and I started taking photos of Woosh next to him, and it wasn't working very well. Everyone was trying to get on the ground to go and kick footies and shit like that. So we decided we would follow him onto the ground, even though he was by himself. He wasn't going to kick the ball. He just wanted to go and stand on the ground, I guess. So we followed him onto the ground and were still taking sneaky photos of him when he wasn't looking. And eventually I was still taking the photos and Woosh stopped him, even though he was on the phone, and asked him for a selfie, and he was very obliging and didn't ask us why we wanted them or anything like that, but was happy to follow our lead, and that's how it happened.
Oh, that's fantastic. Oh, absolutely fantastic.
Paddles is envious, aren't you, Pads, because you've wanted this for years.
Yeah, I've never got to go down to a Richmond game in Melbourne.
Did you spot Mustache Man or Baldy at all?
No, I think I was so fixated on him that I couldn't look anywhere else. So by the time we got down to finding him, we weren't...
Hashtag tension.
Oh. By the time we got down there, he was the only thing we were caring about. So my next mission is to find Baldy, and then we'll move on from there.
I reckon it's going to be hard to spot oldie because I reckon he's like a casual fan.
Coaching the Suns, isn't he?
You mentioned that KFC Boy was very magnanimous about the whole affair and didn't ask why he wanted the photos or anything. Be honest, did you lead him on? And did he think he was going to sort of get some?
Yeah. Did you give him a bit of a tease?
Oh, well, we were nice to him. We wanted something from him. So we weren't. I wish might have given him a bit of a touch up. I'm not sure. I didn't touch him. But, after photos, he introduced himself to me. He was very nice. And yeah, sorry.
It sounds like you left him brokenhearted, actually.
No, we're going to. Yeah. Very
Did you at least give him your number?
No, but I know where I can find him next time.
Let's go to thread of the week, vlog of the week. We'll go through them real quick. Anyone got anything?
The Chris Dawes Oracle thread.
Oh, yeah. Great thread. Yep. Mm-hmm. Yep, down with that.
Standard. It's actually kind of a quiet week on the bay this week.
Honourable mention to LW reviving the big dog thread, but I think it's, got to be the Oracle.
Good seeing new vlogs on the bay.
I agree.
Vlog of the week. I think we got a bit more variety here.
Yeah, I noticed fucking Legend is back on the bay, so fuck you, Legend. You're a shit poster. I noticed you were gone for 6 months after the grand final and going to be gone for another 6 months when we fuck you up on the weekend.
Yeah, fuck off, Legend.
Yeah.
I'm with you, Penal. Legend is a fucking dipstick.
I've never really worried about him, but he does come across as an A-grade toss bucket. So
I was actually only going to give him my dishonorable mention, but he just sort of made me so angry because
you got melted by Legend.
Yeah,
that's embarrassing. That's like Paul Ruse getting melted by goo.
It's like getting melted by fucking Tazork or someone. It's so embarrassing.
I think that actually has happened with some folks before.
Yeah, I was actually going to nominate that NBA man guy, but yeah.
I'll nominate him.
For this Carlton Sook. I want to nominate another Carlton Sook. We go for PMs as being getting angry across multiple, nowhere specific, just over threads, long-winded essays, getting angry at people, and ultra-defensive. Like, he's almost in denial of Carlton's shitness, and he's usually a good poster, but I think he's just cracked, and it's always good when they just crack the usually resolute posters.
But yeah, happy to give it to Legend. He's our flog of the week.
Last week's poll, the worst player in the AFL, 4.8% said Jack Watts, 14.3% said Ryan Schoenmakers, 19% said Liam Jones, and 61.9% said no AFL player is as bad at football as Basil Zemplis is at commentary.
Is this the first poll that Jack Watts didn't win?
No, he lost to someone a few weeks ago, actually.
Franco Cotso.
But yeah, Jack Watts didn't win. Jack Watts came last. That's how far Jack Watts has fallen. Let's move on to next week. Friday night. Well, hooray. Carlton are on Friday night again against the Concerning Cats. Does anyone give Carlton a hope in hell?
No.
If Geelong managed to play the worst game of all time and somehow show up with a pack of 10-year-olds, then yeah, Carlton are a chance, but...
Carlton are no chance.
Geelong by about 120.
Yep.
Goals.
Teach.
Okay,
he's waiting for me to go, fine, I'll go. Geelong are fucking shit. Geelong are a terrible team, but they'll still win this match by about 80 points because Carlton are so much worse.
Teach.
Cats by plenty.
All right, Pads, what was your tip?
I can, yeah.
Oh, fuck off.
The only thing Carlton can hope for is that Geelong plays a poison lasagna.
Yep.
St Kilda West Coast, this could be interesting at Etihad. I think West Coast will win the way they're playing, but St Kilda aren't terrible.
This is going to be a really good game.
We play good at Etihad, but it depends on how well we can stop Kennedy because, I mean, key forwards do tend to tear us a new arsehole. I mean, Cloak played pretty well against us.
And Heater hasn't played well against anyone.
Do you think Rewalt will play? Do you think he's getting it back? All right, so Armitage won't have anyone to kick it to. That'll be disappointing. I think West Coast will win based on that.
West Coast
to win, but not by as much as people might think. It'll be closer than they're expecting.
I actually reckon St Kilda will win.
Ooh, yeah, I'm with you, Paddles. I think the Saints are going to get up.
But at least no one's as fucking bad a tipper as Dan, who tipped Melbourne to beat us.
Oh, wow. Jesus. What a retard.
Listen to Mr. Middle of the Road in the five-man tipping
competition. I'll say St Kilda to win, going from the heart here. And I would like to point out I am winning my six-man tipping comp, so I'm better tipper than Teach.
It's called pacing yourself. Sometimes you've got to sit in the middle of the pack. You know, just behind the leaders, let them get comfortable and worn out
go,
from the pressure of being in the lead. Then the end, just cruise on by.
Giants, Crows. Giants for me. They're up and about. They're playing at home and fucking stop them.
Yeah, I'm going Giants and I like watching them play. I really enjoy it.
You like watching a key forward who can kick straight.
Shut up. I like Dylan Sheil. I like Treloar. I think they're great. They play good football. Just don't do it against us.
I reckon the Crows will get up because if there's one thing they do well, it's beat up on the expansion sides because I think they're one of the few that are left in the running. And I think they'll win. Eddie Betts to kick a bag, 6 or 7. And won't Carlton fans be missing him?
I have to go for Giants. I mean, Adelaide are a good team, but Giants, they look like they're something special. They just got something about them that means that they're going to dominate this league in a few years' time. So.
Yeah, doesn't it just suck how Carlton didn't get any picks, but the Giants got so many? And
yeah, that's terrible.
Yeah.
Well,
it's a tragedy.
We hate the fact that Carlton didn't get any picks. Fuck them.
NBA man says it's unfair, so it's clearly unfair.
Isn't the team that have been hit the hardest by, like, the Giants and the Suns coming into league Port, and they seem to have sort of
Port,
done all
West
right?
Coast and Richmond, I think, got the worst of it.
And so I'd say North as well, because they couldn't get any decent players, but Carlton...
North never bottomed out, though. Like, they weren't robbed of a 1, 2, 3 pick.
Yeah, but getting picked like 25 instead
of
picking.
North
10.
Were robbed of David Swallow.
I reckon Adelaide might win this. Yeah.
I'm going to say it's going to be a draw.
A draw.
The Giants will win because Sloan's out, Jantz is out. They've got a bunch of injuries in Adelaide. No, I reckon the Giants can cover them.
Gold Coast, Collingwood.
Collingwood.
I think Collingwood bounce
back. Oh, yeah, Collingwood.
Collingwood.
Well, I hope we win. I will be there. And I wouldn't be overly confident on what we showed last week, but then again, Gold Coast were absolutely fucking terrible. So hoping for a win.
Yeah, the Scum will win.
Thanks, Paddles.
I have to go for Collingwood. And Clark to kick 2 goals, 5.
Grand final rematch, the Tassie Hawks versus the Colas. John Lewis is back, is he not?
Lewis is back, Hodge is still out.
Where's this being played?
MCG, neutral turf.
Jeez, this is the game of the round.
Yeah, it is.
Evidently.
I'm going to go the Colas, actually.
I reckon Tassie will win.
Yeah, Tassie.
I'm going with Teach. I'm going for the Sydney Swans. I just think they're playing a bit better at the moment. And their midfield's probably also playing a bit better in midfield's win games. So, yeah, Colas by like 5 points.
Rising star winner Billy Harter will 20-3. And the Hawthorn, the Melbourne-based win by 7+.
Masturbation. Masturbation.
Well, I've taken everything you've just said under consideration, Penal. Sydney to win.
Based on what, though? Their backline is shit.
Franklin kick a bag.
Or someone.
Parker to 13-6. Tom Mitchell to 25-5.
Let's move on to North going west to Perth to play that undefeated team. I think they'll lose.
Yeah, I also think that North will lose away from home.
Yeah, game in the west. Yeah. That currently undefeated team to remain undefeated.
Yeah, I think that not-Norf will win.
Yeah, North will lose.
Not-Norf.
North's opponents to win.
Yeah, that team with the shittest theme song in the league, I win.
Paddles, the Brions versus the Scum.
Oh, we played. Rockcliffe will kick a winning goal 50 metres out.
He will not get an inside 50.
What if he gets a 50-metre penalty? Sorry, 2 50-metre penalties.
Well, Melksham could give that away with a brain fade like last week. The Scum will win.
Yeah, going to have to go with the Scum.
I reckon that because it's in Melbourne, because it's in Etihad, they won't have Brion the Lion there, which won't rev the players up, and Essendon will win.
They'll get milled in the dark by Essendon's pre-match show.
Yeah, I have to go for Essendon. They just look rather better than the Lions.
Until last week, they were talking about the Lions not winning a game all year. Okay, they beat Port. Well done. They're not going to beat us this week. The end.
Oh, it'll be reasonably close, though.
They've got confidence.
10 goals.
I don't think we'll crush them because we're not that good, but I think we'll win.
Yeah.
Essendon
by 20-odd.
Yeah, Essendon's peptide starts to wear off around this time of year, so I reckon we could actually win this.
Right. Does anyone give Melbourne a show against the Dogs?
Nah.
MCG, nah. But the Dogs will win.
Nah.
Get on the puppies.
No, not really.
Yeah.
Let's go to the last game of the round, and it's the rematch of that elimination final catastrophe. Port versus Richmond at the Adelaide Oval, and well, hopefully Cochin kicks with the wind. You'll be able to look at the bay cover and see which way it's being blown to, but we won't win. There'll be a crowd of about, 16,000 there, much like Carlton's game this week.
Yeah, I mean, we joked about the...
For Sunday, partly cloudy, winds northeasterly, Trent, 15 to 20 kilometres per hour.
we sort of joked about the crowds last week, and that was before the Brisbane game, and we all expected Port to win that. Just imagine how fucking bad the crowds will be now that they've lost to Brisbane. Like, they'll be lucky to break 20,000.
They're going to be like a pack of angry bees, and they're going to fucking rip Richmond apart.
Richmond are a fin to chance, but they need everything to go right.
They will never tear us apart. You know why? Because they won't have anyone there to sing the fucking song.
They'll just put it through the pipeline and just put some crowd piping in. It's what they always do with Port.
Yeah, well, they like to copy the Crows, so, you know, it's not surprising.
They're essentially Adelaide light.
They are, yeah. Just another South Australian franchise.
You can't expect much from a club that was established in, what, 1996 or something?
And has to, you know, use a pop song from the same era to engage their fans.
Pop song from the era is most of the fashion that their supporters wear.
They got the Billy Ray Cyrus style going.
Fuck, I was going out to discos back then.
And not that he's a punchy man, but Hardwick will be catching the bus back to the hotel because it's been banned in Adelaide. Coaches walking back to the hotel ever since the angry midget decided to go for a wander.
Can't walk across the bridge. No. You better catch the bus.
You will not walk home, you cunt.
Even if someone pisses on the steering wheel.
If they piss on the steering wheel, too bad. Has anyone not tipped?
Yeah, I'm going for Port.
Yeah, Port. Oh, I don't know. Port.
Port will win.
Yeah, Port will win.
So is their new theme song, You'll Never Walk Out Home? It's like you have to catch the bus instead.
Wouldn't happen at a Crows game because you're more likely to get stabbed with a knitting needle or something, but certainly the Port ferals are...
But it wouldn't happen after a Crows game because they all leave early. So.
They need to get their bedtime. They need to go to Country Kitchen Buffet.
Hey, but at least the Crows fans turn up. Unlike the Port ones.
At least you don't have to go out to fucking Westlakes anymore to watch the footy.
At least you don't have to go out to fucking Geelong. I mean, imagine having to trek out to fucking shit old stadium every second week.
Or imagine being a Carlton supporter and having to go to Carlton games every week. That would suck.
Well, only 16,000 of them did.
Yeah, they've given up, haven't they? They've broken.
Now. Not even a barbecue will get them back.
Supporting the Northern Blues.
Anyway, this was the Flogcast for round 8. Starburns joined by Penal.
See ya.
Cooksen.
Bye.
Teach.
Adios.
Haduken.
Auf Wiedersehen.
Morganashlee.
Farewell.
And Paddles.
Adios.
Thanks for listening. We'll see you next week.